The Toy People are about to celebrate their 40th anniversary, and we thought it'd be rather nice to do their story. Now, I've got some good news and I've got some bad news. The bad news is that the Corgi factory is in China. But the good news is that the museum is in Rochdale.
Which for me is just a bus ride away. But why Rochdale? Well, there was a chap there who collected so many corgis, they built him his own museum.
I love my dog as much as I love you. Though you may fade, my dog will always come through.
Along with their great rivals Dinky, Corgi's cars, trucks, buses and tractors were an essential part of a great British childhood. They knew the champagne set, but they also did cars with as much fizz as Corporation Pop. And you could sleep easy knowing that they were all thoroughly checked by the Corgi technocrats. But once upon a time, it was all very different.
Now, Chris, this isn't really what I think of when I think of Corgi.
No, this is the very early beginnings of the Corgi Company. Actually, it was the Metoy Company, which was set up in 1934 when two German gentlemen, Arthur Katz and Philip Ullmann, came over and started producing tin toys in Northampton.
Yeah, it's tin, isn't it? Tin plate. And it seems incredibly fragile for a child's toy. I think it would have lasted all of 15 minutes in our house. And these doors, the edges are like razors.
Yeah, it certainly wouldn't pass the stringent health and safety regulations of today.
So what came after this?
After that, we moved on to the die-casting process, of which Corgi are so famous.
What is die-casting?
Die-casting, very simply, is injection moulding of zinc alloy.
So this was the first Corgi?
That was the first one, produced in 1956, the Ford Consul.
And it's got windows?
Well, Corgi, the ones with windows.
What are some of these others here?
Well, we've got obviously the famous Riley Pathfinder, both in the saloon version and the police version.
My grandfather drove a police Riley Pathfinder.
Did he really?
Yeah.
The Hillman Husky, the Morris Cowley Saloon, and also the Austin Cambridge.
What about this one, though? This is my favourite here. The sporty... It looks like, what is it, an Austin Healey?
I think that could be an MGA. Just have a look.
It's an MGA. Shows how much I know. I think a lot of people will find that packaging, the blue and yellow packaging, very evocative.
Well, that's synonymous with Corgi toys. I certainly grew up with that, as I suppose you might have done.
Bit before my time, that, Chris. But let's have a look at some more packaging here, because they really knew how to sell models, didn't they? I mean, look at that. Look at that diorama. It's wonderful, isn't it?
That was in the shops in the 60s, and it's saying to me, just come and buy me. Today, that is worth an awful lot of money, that particular set of three Monte Carlo rally cars.
And here we've got the Golden Jacks wheels. Golden Jacks.
Golden Jacks.
Wasn't that... The wheels came off on the...
Actually, if we look in this one, on the Rover... 2002C.
I had that one.
Did you?
Yeah, with the spare wheel on the boot lid.
I don't think this has ever actually been out of its box before, but...
Surely not.
Here we go. So basically, as all kids do, flick that down, off comes the wheel and it's time for a change. So if you want alloys or spokes, they were available.
Oh, come, don't be so naive. I think what Corgi realised was that these wheels coming off like that would get eaten by smaller children and would just get lost underneath the sofa or down the back of the carpet.
So they go out and buy another set?
Well, they came in packs of 12. I mean, name me a car that needs 12 spare wheels.
But why would two German businessmen name the company after a Welsh dog?
Second factory was set up in Swansea in South Wales, and Corgi is the name of a Welsh dog. So it appeared very appropriate to call the product that, in addition to which Corgi is a catchy name, it's easy to say, and it stuck.
Yeah, I suppose it's they might not have been quite so popular if it was Rottweiler toys.
Not really, no.
But the factory's in China now, isn't it?
Yes, but all the design and pre-model work is done in the UK.
So how do you make a Corgi?
Once we've decided which model we're making, we go out and measure it, and we come up with this pattern, a 1 to 12 scale lime piece of wood.
This is how I would expect a full-size car to be made at this stage.
The process is very similar, but then we go on to a resin model. This is when we start to scale it down. There are certain areas, you'll see the window struts, for instance, that cannot be scaled down to the same, say, 1/43 or 1/50, because it can become too brittle and too fine, so those are never really in proportion.
So once you've scaled it down, we end up with one of these.
That's right. That is the metal casting, as we call it.
And of course, we also need all of these bits.
Those are all little plastic bits, and they're ready to be broken off and fit into what we call a sub-assembly. They could be wheels or axles or...
Yeah, I can see the steering wheel there.
That's
and,
right.
And there's the nutter on the bus.
Oh, yes! That's right.
And finally, what are these?
That is the finished, painted, assembled article.
A sharra.
A real sharra, yeah.
On its way to Southport.
Yeah.
It feels a really hefty piece of kit, this.
It's very well made, it's durable, it's built to last. It'll stand about a quarter of a tonne of pressure, that model.
Are you sure?
I'm not going to try it.
I'll try it. Let's see if it will stand a quarter of a tonne of pressure.
And apart from a bit of give in the front axle, it did.
Chipperfields, this is really what got Corgi going, isn't it?
Yes, Steve, I mean, it's a fantastic range. Corgi is synonymous with the Chipperfield Circus range.
I had this one, I had the menagerie with the plastic lions, and I had the horse transporter and the Land Rovers, and I had this one over here. I had the Poodle Parlour in Parlour.
You had the Poodle Parlour. That's worth about £300 now in pristine mint condition.
Really?
What
about for the lot? What about for a full Chipperfield set? How much?
Well, there's probably about £2,500 worth of models in that cabinet alone, at a conservative estimate, yeah. But I've got something over here that you may be very interested in.
Holy marketing ploys, Batman! In the 60s, Corgi realised the mileage they could get from the cars and submarines of the stars.
Yellow submarine, yellow submarine.
Hey, hey, with the monkeys! People say we monkey around.
The Aston Martin DB5 from Goldfinger was first made in 1965. They still make it today, and so far they've shifted 14 million.
The 60s and 70s was a period where a lot of what we call character merchandise was produced by Corgi.
Yeah, we got the Bond Lotus.
Esprit, that's right.
The Aston. The yep. Toyota 2000 GT, the Batmobile. But what about this, the Bat Bike? I don't remember the Bat Bike or the Spider Bike. I don't remember them ever being in...
If Corgi made them, Steve, he must have had one, surely.
I thought the whole point of Spider-Man was that he got around like a spider, not in a Jeep Renegade.
Yeah, but maybe he just had a bike as a backup or something. I honestly don't know.
I like this one down here, the rather bizarrely named Thrushbuster from The Man from U.N.C.L.E. What I can't work out is, if they were secret agents, why would they have the name in big letters on the bonnet?
I honestly don't know again, but...
And of course, mint and boxed.
Mint and boxed, yeah. These models in pristine condition have really never been played with. So.
Well, do you not think that's a bit sad? I mean, mine were... The boxes, they were ripped out of the boxes. The boxes were discarded without a moment's consideration.
That's right, but if you've got boxes these days, that is why they're worth such a lot of money. I mean,
I would say if you've got boxes, you're very sad. Sorry, Chris.
Corgi is still going strong, but don't call them toys, they're models. They're still as collectible. This Inspector Morse Jag sold for less than a tenner just a couple of years ago. Now it's worth £75.
This is the latest development in a 1/18 scale model from Corgi. Designed on the 1963 MGB and the latest MGF from Rover.
Yeah, but Chris, they're very nice, but you know what the problem is, don't you?
What's that?
Well, as little boys get bigger, so do their toys. Now, I shouldn't really be showing you this, so don't tell anyone. It'll be our little secret. I say the magic words, William Willard! Now then, this is my idea of a toy car.